Do some of y'all come up out there? Y'all remember that?
Yes.
Okay. You ain't grown for a minute. That ain't none of your business. Get on out there. And then what happens? They ask you again. Pop me in my mouth. But that's where some of us are spiritual in our lives. Sometimes, and I have a friend who said this, we got to understand the process of salvation. When you get saved and you just start out knowing the faith, you're not a mature Christian. You are still a babe. And what happens is when a babe, when somebody is growing up, they eat. They're growing. They eat a lot. Who here has ever had a teenager? Who's ever here been a teenager? They eat. Because they're growing. If they don't eat, they're dying. One of the reasons that we're dying is because we're not eating what God has for us. We're not in the Word. We're not praying. We're not with the people of God. And why are we not with the people of God? Because when we look in the mirror, we look at ourselves, and we look at ourselves, and we see ourselves in mortality than we are. We have arrived. And thank you, Holy Spirit. One of the reasons that we think that we've arrived is because we've got religion. That's what we talked about last week. We got religion. We know the rituals. We know when to buck and shout when we say the right things. We know the right words to say. We know how to act in front of church folk. But when we get home, in the darkest places of our home, we sit in our rooms and we don't like what we see and we don't like who we are. But what do we do? Humility tells us, or pride tells us, that we got to go put on a face. And then the word was, we put that face onto ourselves. But understand this, some of us in this room are mature Christians. Some of us are not. If you're not a mature Christian, you just got to accept that, because that's going to set you in a place where you begin to learn. Some of the places that we mess up, and I say this with my personal life, I love to help people. But sometimes we want to help people, but we ain't ready to help people. That's what Galatians says. Galatians says when you go and you correct a brother, excuse me, 1 Corinthians, it says you got to make sure that you don't fall first in that old witness if you're going to help them. Sometimes we can't help our brothers quite yet. This is a mature word. Sometimes you can't help these people in your life yet. Why? Because you're not mature yet. You just need to help yourself first. And that's okay. Let's not get upset when we got to help ourselves. Sometimes we got to help. Sometimes when people come to us and they ask us for something, sometimes we got to say, you know what? Well, let me get my stuff together first. But we help others because we build our heart and not walk in humility. We're babes in Christ. Ask yourself, how much do you know about the Word of God? One of the things that somebody told me is this: the more wisdom you have, the more you know that you're not wise. The more you know, the more you know how much you don't know. Every time I practice word, I realize how much less I know. I think I know, but I really don't. So you know what? I gotta take this up. Let me tell you, when we got out there with the Clobber passages, and I said this, and I'm about to wrap up, but when we got into the Clobber passages, I sat there and read that stuff, and the more I started reading it, the more I started learning. I learned more. I feel like I learned more than the people who I was teaching on the Clobber passages, because I really did learn. Humble yourself and be able to say you need to learn something. You need to do something different. Amen. Let's move on. If we don't do that, we set ourselves up for failure. Because what happens? It says pride cometh before what? It doesn't say a fall. It says a hearty fall. A big fall. It don't say you just going to fall. You're going to fall and make a mess. When you walk and you start going out here and saying, oh, well, you know what? I'm a mature Christian. Let me give you one more example to this, because I feel this in my spirit. If we go out here and I give you a gun and say, you're a police officer, but you haven't gotten the training, guess what? You go down there to the hood, you're not coming back out. Because they're going to take your gun and shoot you with it. But that's what we do. We out here trying to walk like we are so highfalutin. Let me tell you, this thing means something to me, because let me tell you, I've lost ministry because of this stuff. I've lost ministry. And I hurt people. And I said, I'm never going to do that again, because I didn't walk in humility. I said, I will never do that again. And you know what? When I said never, then I realized I started slipping and then I have to go and check myself again. Glory be to God. Number three, study the Word of God. I say this, the first step is to read it. One of the things I do, and I want to make this real simple, I'm almost through. On this, it has a little button, and what you can do is you can actually set up an account. I want to make this real simple. You can set up an account, and what it does is when you read a verse, it will, you can set it to record where you stopped. Now, to make it even better, it reads to you. So if you go to this, and you study, and you have that, and you read it to you, then look, not only this, but if I don't have this movie, I have an account. So then what happens is I have my phone. So when I'm at home and I don't have my tablet, then I can pull it up on my phone and it says the same spot, the same version, everything, and I can keep going. But the thing, what it does is it tells on you because it tells you the last time you read it. So when you open up your app, and it doesn't tell you, if it tells you 4 weeks, it tells you 2 weeks, and I've been there, I ain't even gonna lie, sometimes I've been there, where it said it's time, or when it's blank, you ain't never read it. You gotta understand where is your soul. You can't, you're struggling to live this Christian life because you haven't fed yourself. You haven't fed, you're starving. Your soul is dying inside. One of the blessed things, and I'm gonna wrap up with this, is that the Bible is a testimony of people's words. It's not a dictation. This is not a book of, oh, God dictating to us. These are people telling their personal stories. What does Ecclesiastes 3 say? There's nothing new under the sun. We talk about polygamy. In the Bible, polygamy is in the Bible. What is polygamy? It's just when people have a play. When you're a player, you got three people on the side. Nothing new under the sun. Last thing, push out the negativity. Get negative folk and negative people out of your space. We sometimes not learn this because, I'm saying this stuff because this is stuff that changed my life. I'm telling my life story. This is what I'm saying. I was around negative people because I was lonely. And I was lonely because it wasn't that I was lonely, it was lonely because I was not seeking God. I needed to seek God. I needed to spend time in God. It wasn't that I needed people around me because I had people around me. They were just negative. And so the next thing I know, I'm all wrapped up, torn, because I had negativity in my life. Last thing I want to say is, we're a Pentecostal church. We're a spirit field. Sometimes you hear Pentecostal, charismatic. One of the unfortunate things for a lot of us, that's why I love for us to go to class. One of the things that we have to do is sometimes we have to reteach people Pentecostalism. Because when we start talking about Pentecostalism, they go back to the old judgmental stuff and wearing dresses and you can't cut your hair, you gotta cut your hair and all that. But all that means is to accept the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues. What is that speaking in tongues? It's not to make a show. It's your prayer language. That's how we talk. It's your prayer language. Ask God, have you received your prayer language? If you haven't received your prayer language and you're calling yourself a Pentecostal member, you may want to ask yourself, how much time have you prayed for it? Have you even studied up on it? Ask yourself, do you need prayers? Do you need your prayer language? Ask God, can I pray in the Spirit? I ain't talking about making shows. I'm just talking about, what does it say? The Spirit prays for us in moanings and groanings, which we can't even comprehend. Sometimes we don't know what to pray. That's why we get the baptism of the Holy Spirit to help us pray when we can't pray. When we don't know what to pray. We don't know what's going to go on. And God is telling us. Another thing, I really want to wrap up with this. I honestly am. What was it one time we talked about? When we got real deep in the Spirit, talk about where we worship in the Spirit. When we worship in our prayer language. These are all things that can build your spiritual walk. You've got to get connected to these things. Because I want to say this, if you are trying to live the Christian life and you're not connected with God, you're going to be frustrated. You're going to be frustrated. Eventually, you're going to walk away because it's too hard. It's impossible. If you're not connected with God and you're not spending the time, it's impossible. God has actually done something impossible. Amen?
Amen.
But get into that presence. When you get into the presence of God, I know sometimes we get into the presence of God and we just feel laying on us. And we feel like God's presence is so deep upon us. We feel that way because God is shedding all this stuff. He's working that change in our lives. He said, you don't even have to do it. I will do it for you. Now we're going to come to this table. I need an usher for me, please. You go ahead and stop the camera too. Amen. You go ahead and do this.